Hi, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Visual Studio Toolbox. I'm your co-host, Leslie Richardson.
And I'm your co-host, Robert Green.
And I'm your guest, Phil Jupixi.
Awesome. And welcome to another edition of Automated Testing on Visual Studio Toolbox, part of the mini-series that we are still presenting. So we've been talking about a lot of different parts of automated testing. We just wrapped up three episodes all about mock in particular, as well as a little bit of a dive into Azure DevOps and some GitHub Actions, which is pretty sweet. And this time around, we're going to be talking about integration testing as it relates to stuff such as EF Core and SQL Server.
Correct. So I want to really stress that we're talking about integration tests here, right, which are not unit tests. Mm-hmm. We kind of had this discussion, I think, a couple episodes ago.
What's the difference, just as a refresher?
So the difference, this is not the academic definition. This is Phil's definition. So a unit test is you're testing an isolated unit of work. Right, an integration test, you're testing multiple pieces, whether that's two different pieces of code that are you're actually running the code as opposed to mocking out. You're going to a database, you're hitting a web service, there's something else that your code is integrated with, right? So it's not isolated. Mm-hmm. So one of the downsides of integration testing your data access layer is it's time consuming, right? So you don't want to run this on every build. Like we talked about how to tie into your CI/CD pipeline, but you don't want your integration test to always run every time you check in, because it's going to be a monumental drain on your resources. Right? And by resources, I mean your Azure, SQL Azure, and those types of things.
Right.
But you still want to have those tests around it. Now, what we do in real life is we do two different types of integration tests, or tests for the data access layer. We do true data tests, two integration tests. We're actually testing all the way down to the data, to the database. So we're adding records, we're deleting records, we're updating records, right? We're getting records. But what we run every time we check in are the mocked tests, right? We talked about mocking in depth, and actually it was a sample repo, right? So we mocked the data access layer out for our unit tests, but for integration tests, we're actually hitting a database.
So just kind of a follow-up to that, and maybe a prelude to this, you can mock so that you're not hitting the actual database. You could also use something like local SQL Server or even SQLite and kind of duplicate, have a sample database that you're actually talking to. What would be the benefit of mocking over that, and is that a reasonable thing to do without having to mock the data layer?
Well, I think anything that moves the ball forward for you is reasonable, mm-hmm. right? So I'm not going to sit here and say it's not reasonable, it is reasonable. If it helps your team progress and become more automated, it's reasonable. One of the downsides, if you're using SQL Server and you decide to set up tests going against SQLite, you're really not testing the exact same platform, mm-hmm. right? So something that works in SQLite might not work in SQL Server, and then you have a false positive,
okay.
or vice versa, right? The other thing that EF Core has, And I correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the EF Core team is actually kind of talking less and less about an in-memory database implementation, so you could swap it out. Now, I played with it, but I never used an in-memory database provider, because it's the same thing, right? I am writing code against SQL Server. If I'm testing against the in-memory database provider, how do I know that they're going to behave exactly the same?
Okay.
Right. So if you're testing code that requires data, but you don't want to test the data layer, you mock out the data layer.
Okay.
I mean, that's just what you do.
Okay.
All right? So as a prelude to this episode, Robert and I did a 15-episode series on EF Core in 2020. And if you haven't seen that, you need to stop this and go watch it now. We'll wait. No, seriously, we're not going to go into
the
mechanics.
There's a ton of resources on EF Core. Those were among them.
Yes.
The docs are great.
Those were best. I mean, what else would you go to? No, I'm just kidding. The docs are really good as well.
But we're going to assume people know EF Core.
Right.
We're going to assume people know SQL Server, and we're just going to focus on the testing part.
Yep, so we're going to cover a couple of things. We're going to cover some practices that you have to include mm-hmm. to make this work effectively. We're also going to expand on our XUnit knowledge. We're going to talk about some setup mechanics that we need to do.
Okay.
So let's start off with a data initialization, and easy for me to say, getting the data in the database. Here I've got some sample data. I only have two tables. If you read any of my books, this is based on the auto lot, so it's very car focused. So we have cars and makes, and that's all mm-hmm. we have, right? I simplified the database. And then I have this code in the initializer where I can clear out the data, and then I can seed the data. And what we want to do, and we talked about this at length earlier, is we want to make sure that in the setup, the test setup, that we have the data that we're expecting. And in the cleanup, we reset the data to how it was when we came in, right? So I have one method that we can call, and it's simply clear and reseed database. Now, what this does is just deletes all the data, adds all the data. It's a very small record set. It's very, very fast. If you're testing against local, to your point earlier, you could just as efficiently drop the database and recreate it. But if your database is in Azure, it's kind of a bad thing. Because you can drop it programmatically, but creating is pretty hard to do in Azure. Actually, pretty near impossible.
Oh.
So here we have just this method, and all it does is go through and add records, you know, clear the records, add a record. Mm-hmm. So let's go back to our tests, and we're using a class fixture, and the class fixture is of type ensure autolot database test fixture. Like I said before, I'm terrible at naming things. But if we look in here, what I'm doing is I'm getting a configuration. So I'm using the ASP.NET Core and .NET Core configuration subsystem.
Okay.
So I've got an app settings.json file. I'm not going to go into depth about how that works, but it allows me to, through a configuration file, right, change what the connection string is.
Okay.
And there's no secrets here. I'm going against LocalDB. Yep. So, and then if you have access to my machine, there's my password and my test, right? So it's complicated.
I've never seen that. Excellent password.
I've never seen that.
Never seen
before,
that one? No, because usually there's a one on the end, right?
That's an exclamation mark.
Yeah.
Very creative, and no one's going to crack that.
So in my ensure fixture here, or my constructor, which runs before the fixture runs, I am getting a configuration. I'm creating an instance of the context, and then I'm clearing and reseeding the database.
Okay.
Now this does the clear and reseed also will create the database if needed, right? If, as long as I'm not running against Azure. So then we look at our tests, creating a new instance of our repo, and then we're going to start calling tests against it. So what I'm testing here is I'm not testing EF Core. Right, I have to believe that EF Core works, and I do. I mean, I'm not saying that snarkily, but I'm not testing the framework.
And you're not testing your individual methods that make calls and do things. You've already tested those, right?
No, this is actually testing the individual methods on the repos. Not the methods on the controllers, but on the repository. Okay. So I use a modified repository pattern. Mm-hmm. So all my data access goes through a repository class.
Okay.
So that allows me to encapsulate logic. I'm coding to an interface so I can inject that in. So my line of business code, all it knows is it says car repo, get all, right? And then cars show up.
Right.
Right. It doesn't have to know that it's EF Core or anything else, right? It just happens to be. So this is testing the data access layer. I'm actually testing the repository.
Okay.
Right?
So is that integration testing? Testing the data access layer?
Yeah, this is integration testing.
So integration testing is basically unit testing the data access layer. Is that a mischaracterization?
Well, unit testing, again, if we're looking at the academic definitions, a unit test is only testing a unit of work.
Right.
And a unit of work is isolated to the smallest functioning piece, which is a method.
Okay.
I'm actually bringing in additional outside forces, right? So it's my C# code, my EF Core code, and the database itself.
Okay.
So you were right with everything except where you said unit testing. It's testing a data access layer.
Got it.
That's one type of integration testing.
Okay.
Right? If I'm calling a web service, if I'm calling a web page, I'm calling something else, right? Those are all file system, for example, right? All integration testing. So what I'm doing here, very simply, is I have my, so I just said don't test EF Core. This is showing how to test EF Core, but I'm also just trying to show how to test with data.
Right.
And these are pretty simple. I am running a query. I'm checking what the query string is. Remember that output helper that we have in XUnit? So this is going to actually show what the query is that's executed.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm asserting that my expected count is correct.
Okay.
Right. So we'll run this. We're not going to run all of the gets because the gets are pretty rudimentary. Right. So it worked. Of course, I have no idea which one it is now. I ran all of them.
kind of wish the Test Explorer would redirect you to like the file in question if you're just trying to quickly return to the
correct
related test.
We have an upcoming episode on unit testing tools in Visual Studio. We should drop that.
So there's my query, right? Mm-hmm. So I can see what the query was when it was executed. What's more important to me in my testing is doing things like inserting a record.
Yeah.
Right? Because now I'm checking that my repository is taking care of things like foreign keys. Mm-hmm. Right? Do those things exist and everything else? But I also don't want to sully the database. So what I have is in this test framework, and this will be in the download or in the GitHub repo, is I have a helper method called execute in a transaction. Oh. Right? So I don't have to keep writing the same thing over and over again. Mm-hmm. And if we look at my base test method, oh, stop. Right? So what I am doing here is I'm creating an execution strategy.
Nice.
I'm executing in an execution strategy, and we talk about this in EF Core, but just as a brief reminder, if you have an execution strategy in play, which I do, I've got the SQL Server retry execution strategy turned on, then you have to run your transaction in an execution strategy. So that's what this boilerplate code is. Mm-hmm. Then here's my using transaction. I am passing in a delegate, right? That's my action. And then I automatically roll back. Now in your production code, obviously you wouldn't automatically roll back. If everything worked, you commit and then roll back, right? But since I am only testing my insert, I don't want to actually do an insert. Right. So I roll it back, so I'm leaving it in the state that it was when I found it. So then here's my local function, mm-hmm. which becomes my delegate that I pass into the executed transaction.
Cool.
Right. Update works the same way. So I have code here, and you notice my asserts are in here. I am getting the first car out of the database. I happen to know what color it is. I know it's a black car. I change it to white. I save changes. I then create a second context. Now, this is important when you're doing testing with EF Core. I already have car one, or the car in context one. It's already in the change tracker. So for me to test against any changes to that is moot because it's already tracking it.
Right.
Right? So if I really want to test what happened in the database, I need to create a new context, call into the database, and see what the values are, mm-hmm. right, to make sure they actually persisted. Something new that you can do and in recent versions of EF Core, I could do this now, which I think would be more efficient. Right, that's a fairly recent feature. So I can clear the change tracker, and then I can use the same context again. And that would be more efficient because creating context has some overhead.
Yeah.
Okay. Remove works the same way. Here's the one thing that I definitely want to show. And it's showing a concurrency exception. So if you go back to our episodes or any documentation, you can get automatically concurrency checking within EF Core by having a row version, at least with SQL Server. And so we always turn it on. Mm-hmm. And so what happens is if you are working with an object, so you pull a customer out of the database, and I pull a customer out of the database. So the row version value for both of our customers is the same. Right? It's automatically handled by SQL Server. Mm-hmm. You make a change and save it, the row version gets updated. So now in the database, primary key of one, row version of 123. Just making a number up, it's a different format. I have primary key of one, but row version is 1111. Mm-hmm. So I go to save it. What happens is EF Core changes the way it saves and says instead of just update where ID equals one, it's update where ID equals one and row version equals, in my case, 1111. Well, that record doesn't exist. Mm-hmm. Right, so what SQL Server says goes, I got nothing to do, so that's fine. Not an exceptional thing, right? I'm not raising a problem. I'm just gonna say, no records returned. The change tracker says, I should have had one record changed. I'm getting zero. I'm gonna throw my hands up and punt, and that gives us this exception right here, which is a DB update concurrency exception.
Okay.
Right, so here, and this is important, because how do you handle the concurrency exception? All EF Core does is say, there's a problem. You as a developer have to determine what to do with that problem, right? You could do the easy thing and say, sorry, Phil, Robert beat you to it, try again. Or you could go as far as look at what I change versus what you change, and then, you know, try and apply some logic to say, oh, we changed different fields, we're going to go ahead and get Robert's copy.
Or just say, you can change the database, I can change the database, you changed first, I change it after I win. Last in wins.
Well, last in wins is typically not a good idea.
Because?
Because it's a principle of least surprise has been broken, right? I just overwrote your data and you don't know it.
What's the difference if I change a record and you come in 3 hours later and change it?
Because you didn't see if you come in 3 hours later and change it, you are seeing the data as it is and then changing it with the knowledge of what the state of the object is. If we're pulling it back and I see that your title is developer, mm-hmm. right? And I update your salary for a developer salary, right? But you actually go in there, not your, you know, Fred Flintstone's title, and you change it to senior developer because mm-hmm. he just got a raise. Mm-hmm. And now I have written his salary to be a developer because I didn't know he was a senior developer because I didn't know there was a difference in the data.
Okay.
If I come in 3 hours later, I've pulled the data, right? So I have a fresh copy of data. I go, oh, he's a senior developer. Mm-hmm. That means salary Y, not X. Right, so that we want to really make sure we don't violate the principle of least surprise.
Okay.
And then this is.
But we digress.
We digress. Well, you know what? This is the first time this series we digressed, isn't it? Leslie starts
now
laughing.
Now we're digressing again.
No, we've done this too much. I guess the whole alias thing was a bit of a digression. All right, so let me show you the test helper through and through. So one thing that I like to do is I use a configuration subsystem, and then this sets the base path to be the current directory. I have a JSON file. Now this is important if you're watching at home, well, you are watching at home. If you have an appsettings.json in one of your test projects and you're using Azure DevOps, I don't know about GitHub Actions because it might have the same problem. But if you have appsettings.json in your test project, you have appsettings.json in your web application, you know, or your RESTful service or mm-hmm. whatever, it might be the one from your test project that actually gets overwritten, or it might be the one that you really want to keep that gets overwritten. We've actually had failures because we had the same name, appsettings.development.json or appsettings.production.json. So what I do is I always add what I'm doing if it's not the mainline application, right? And because I'm creating the configuration subsystem here basically from scratch using the framework, then I can name it whatever I want, right? I always have a helper method that says, go get me the context based on the whole configuration system. Mm-hmm. And then here is the get secondary context, and the get secondary context is what allows me to do that concurrency checking and to make sure things got updated. And then just to show you, in the base test class, I have execute in a transaction. We talked about this. But you can also execute in a shared transaction. And so this means context one is in a transaction, context two is in the same transaction. I haven't committed the changes yet. So if I wasn't in the same transaction, context two wouldn't see the changes, wouldn't be able to verify it. So you can share transactions between DB context. And that is as simple as setting the transaction using the transaction coming from the existing transaction.
Mm.
Okay. So, any questions? All right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, pretty good.
So, again, just safety tip, do not plug these into your CI/CD pipeline, right? Because you're going to be testing. You know, we've got hundreds of tests that hit the database. We do not want those running every time we check in. It's going to drive up your cost. It's going to slow down your performance.
Yep. All right.
Sweet.
All right.
Words to live by. So we are in the home stretch of our series, right? So closing out with the next episode.
Yeah.
So what are we going to do to wrap things up?
We're going to talk about UI testing, automated UI testing.
Awesome. Looking forward to UI testing. So stay tuned for that. And we are on the final episode, so don't miss it. And until next time, happy coding. We'll be right back.